Viewers, this video we will continue with sickle cell anemia. In the previous video, we have seen the RBCs are normally round in shape. It will become sickle cells or crescent shaped cells in sickle cell anemia. That was due to abnormal beta chain present in the RBC or present in the hemoglobin. This video will discuss about the clinical features and the management of a child with the sickle cell disease or sickle cell anemia. First, we will see the clinical features. The clinical features are very important because this is a common question asked in the university exam of nursing students. Also, it is very important because several multiple choice questions have been asked in the previous staff nurse examination for the selection of nursing officer or staff, both in the central government institute and in the state government institute. First, let us see the manifestations in sickle cell trait. The sickle cell trait is often asymptomatic. Why? Because one hemoglobin only abnormal, the other hemoglobin is normal in children with the sickle cell trait. The only symptom that may be present is the painless gross hematuria. Why it occurs? It is due to renal papillary necrosis in the kidney. That is the first set of clinical manifestation, what occurs in sickle cell trait. Coming to the second set of clinical manifestation, that is what happens in children with the sickle cell disease. Sickle cell trait is different, sickle cell disease is different. In sickle cell trait, it is almost asymptomatic. But in sickle cell trait, there are variety of clinical manifestation. In sickle cell disease, children will start to manifest the symptom after 6 months of age. Why they will not produce any manifestation before 6 months? Because before 6 months, there is enough level of HbF to maintain the hemoglobin level in the blood. But after 6 months, the hemoglobin F decreases and the hemoglobin S, that is the sickled hemoglobin level, increases. So there is no enough hemoglobin in the blood. As a result, the child will start to demonstrate symptoms after 6 months of age. The symptoms include acute symptom. The acute symptom, we can see 4 important crises. In a child with a sickle cell crisis, the symptoms will start after 6 months. Then it include acute symptom. Under the acute symptom, we can see 4 types of crises. These are very important. First one, acute hemolytic crisis. Second, splenic sequestration crisis. Third, aplastic crisis. 4, vaso-occlusive events. Coming to first crisis, that is acute hemolytic crisis. It occurs rarely. It is due to hyperhemolysis, that is destruction of RBC within the blood vessel, that is intravascular, and outside the blood vessel, that is extravascular, due to mild oxygen deficiency, or it is triggered by mild oxygen deficiency. Acute hemolytic crisis is otherwise due to hyperhemolysis. It is due to widespread hemolysis of abnormal RBC within the blood vessel and outside the blood vessel. It is even triggered by mild oxygen deficiency. The second type of crisis is splenic sequestration crisis. Sequestration means accumulation. Accumulation of what? It is accumulation of blood within the spleen. How it occurs? If there is splenic vaso-occlusion, there is entrapment and pooling of large amount of blood within the spleen. This vaso-occlusion can occur sickling of RBC within the blood vessels of the spleen. So, there is accumulation of large amount of blood within the spleen. That will lead to accumulation of large amount of blood or entrapment of blood within the spleen leads to acute left upper quadrant pain, because that is a space where spleen is seen. Then anemia, reticulocytosis, due to accumulation of blood, the RBC will be decreased in the other parts of the body. So there is increased production of premature RBC, that is nothing but reticulocyte, that is called reticulocytosis. Anemia, it is due to destruction of RBCs within the spleen, and there is signs of intravascular volume depletion because large amount of blood is trapped within the spleen. That is what is called the splenic sequestration crisis. Those who are preparing for staff nurse examination, remember the features of splenic sequestration crisis. It is due to entrapment of blood within the spleen, and the features are acute left upper quadrant pain, anemia, reticulocytosis, and signs of intravascular volume depletion. The third type of crisis is aplastic crisis. Here, there is aplastic anemia with acute and severe drop in hemoglobin and associated reticulocytopenia. So, what is aplastic crisis? There is sudden aplastic anemia with acute and severe drop in hemoglobin and associated reticulocytopenia. Then, the dysmorphic erythrocyte or the deformed or the malformed erythrocyte in sickle cell disease are susceptible to parvovirus B19 infection. It can temporarily suppress the bone marrow erythropoiesis. Within the bone marrow, we know there is production of RBC, and that is called erythropoiesis. This erythropoiesis can be suppressed temporarily by parvovirus B19 infection. This infection occurs in children with a sickle cell disease due to dysmorphic erythrocyte, due to the presence of deformed erythrocytes or malformed erythrocyte. If there is this infection, that can lead to aplastic crisis. Aplastic crisis is nothing but sudden drop in the production of erythrocytes, resulting in acute severe drop in hemoglobin and associated reticulocytopenia. It is a third type of crisis. The fourth type of crisis is vaso-occlusive crisis. Vaso-occlusive crises are very painful episodes. Otherwise, they are called a painful crisis. There are recurrent episodes of severe deep bone pain and dactylitis. The dactylitis is the inflammation of the fingers. The most common symptom in children and adolescents. Dactylitis is the most common symptom in children and adolescents with the sickle cell anemia. Those who are preparing for staff nurse examination, remember this point. The other features, we are discussing the clinical manifestation of children with the sickle cell anemia. We are seeing it under acute symptom. First acute symptom is four types of crisis. The second acute symptom is different type of infection. It can be pneumonia, meningitis, osteomyelitis, and sepsis. Osteomyelitis is the most common cause, always remember for MCQ. It is Salmonella and Staphylococcus aureus. Then the sepsis, the most common cause is Streptococcus pneumonia in children with the sickle cell anemia. Other acute symptoms include acute chest syndrome, priapism, stroke, and infarctions of virtually any organ, especially spleen. That was the end of acute symptom. Now we will see the second category of symptom present in children with sickle cell anemia, that is chronic symptom. It includes chronic hemolytic anemia manifested by fatigue, weakness and pallor, chronic pain and polylithiasis. Polylithiasis is nothing but presence of gallstones or stones in the gallbladder. Coming to the complications of clinical under clinical manifestation. This is the third heading. First heading is acute symptom, second is chronic symptom, and third is complication. The complication can occur every organ in the body. Here we will mention the important organ with the complication. First, the complication is the spleen. It is functional asplenia, increased risk of infection. Streptococcus pneumonia is the most common organism. So because of increased risk of infection and a repeated infarction of the spleen, in sickle cell patient, the spleen is often atrophied rather than enlarged. In children with sickle cell anemia or sickle cell patient, the spleen is atrophied or it is smaller in size. It is not enlarged in size. In other hemolytic condition, we can see the spleen as enlarged, but here it is atrophied. It is another common question in MCQ. It is due to repeated infarction of the spleen. In the kidney, the complications are renal capillary necrosis, glomerulonephritis, end-stage renal failure. The skeletal complications are avascular necrosis, osteonecrosis of the femoral head, growth impairment, and osteoporosis. The CNS, the complications are recurrent stroke. The male genital can get priapism. In the lungs, there can be pulmonary hypertension and acute chest syndrome. In the heart, there is cardiomyopathy, heart failure, and myocardial infarction. In the eye, there is retinal vessel occlusion. In this slide, you can see the summary of complication and clinical features in children with the sickle cell disease. From the head, in the brain, there is stroke. In the eye, there is retinal vessel occlusion. In the heart, there is heart failure. The spleen, splenic atrophy. It is otherwise called autosplenectomy. This is another MCQ question. Autosplenectomy occurs in sickle cell disease. Then in the penis there is priapism, skin there is dactylitis and ulcers, always remember. In the liver, gallbladder, there is gallstones. This is another important area in MCQ. Bones and joints, it is hand-foot syndrome and osteonecrosis. In the kidney, there is renal failure and hematuria. In the lung, there is acute chest syndrome and pneumonia. So far we have seen the clinical manifestation, very important question in the university examination for nursing students, and several multiple choice questions have been asked in the staff nurse examination. Coming to the diagnosis, it can be diagnosed prenatally. How? It can be identified by chorion-villus sampling and DNA analysis at 8 to 12 weeks of pregnancy. Then the neonates also, it can be identified by hemoglobin electrophoresis. It is the gold standard, or it is a test that confirms the presence of sickle cell anemia in neonates. Coming to the diagnosis of older children and adult, it includes liquid chromatography and isoelectric focusing, sickle cell test, peripheral blood smear and X-ray of the skull. The X-ray of the skull shows a significant feature that is called a hair on end appearance or crew cut sign. Remember, crew cut sign or hair on end appearance is seen in skull X-ray of children with the sickle cell disease. Another common question in MCQ. And why it occurs? It is due to erythropoietic bone marrow hyperplasia. In order to compensate for chronic anemia, every bone in the body or every bone marrow in the body will undergo hyperplasia, including that of skull bones. That is called a erythropoietic bone marrow hyperplasia. In the skull, it will produce hair on end appearance or crew cut sign. Coming to the treatment, we have covered clinical features under acute, chronic and complication. We have covered a diagnosis under prenatal, neonatal, older adults and children. Now we will see the treatment. The treatment is only long term because it is a long term condition and there is no cure for it. First important thing in the treatment is prevention of infection. How it can be done? By administering vaccines. Very important, pneumococcal vaccine and meningococcal vaccine. Another method to prevent infection is daily penicillin prophylaxis at least until 5 years of age. Then, if sepsis is suspected, we have seen sepsis is one of the common acute symptoms. If there is sepsis, then treat with the IV third generation cephalosporin, example ceftriaxone. If meningitis is suspected, another infection that can occur under acute symptom, add vancomycin to third generation cephalosporin. Then, if the child is allergic to third generation cephalosporin or vancomycin, there is second line therapy with the levofloxacin and clindamycin. This is a way of treatment of infection in children with the sickle cell anemia. Coming to prevention of sickle cell crisis, it includes avoid triggers. Now, what are the triggers? In the earlier video, we have discussed some of the conditions that will reduce oxygen level in the blood. If there is reduced oxygen level, that will predispose to sickling. So those conditions are called triggers. We have discussed 7 conditions. Those who are doubtful, please visit the previous video. So avoiding of those triggers are important to prevent sickle cell crisis. Then it can be further prevented by administering a drug called hydroxyurea. It is a first line treatment. It will reduce sickle cell crisis because it stimulates erythropoiesis. Then we can manage the anemia by blood transfusion, folic acid supplementation and cholecystectomy. Folic acid supplementation is done because there is rapid destruction of RBC and increased use of folic acid. In order to compensate this mechanism, we have to treat the child with the folic acid supplementation to avoid folic acid deficiency. This is another common MCQ. Folate deficiency can occur in children with the sickle cell anemia, so folic acid supplementation is essential. Cholecystectomy is done because we have seen gallstone is the complication of this disorder. The third important management is management of acute sickle cell crisis. We have seen how it can be prevented. Then here we will see if at all any sickle cell crisis occurs. Four different crises we have seen. If any such a crisis occurs, how it can be managed? It has to be managed with hydration because dehydration is an important risk factor in aggravating the crisis. So appropriate hydration is important. Then it is a very painful condition. So pain management with the NSAID and opioids are essential. Thrombolism or thromboembolic phenomenon is very common because of vaso-occlusion. So thromboembolic prophylaxis is important. Then nasal oxygen is important. Bed rest is essential. Also, we have to transfuse blood and also do exchange transfusion in order to remove sickled RBC from the body. The fourth and the last part of treatment is allogenic bone marrow transplantation. This is a curative therapy. Allogenic bone marrow transplantation. In addition, gene therapy is evolving technique to provide curation in children with the sickle cell anemia. As we have seen, the management of a child with the sickle cell anemia under four heading, the management is long term. There is no short term management because this is a chronic condition. We have seen the long-term management under prevention of infection, prevention of sickle cell crisis, management of sickle cell crisis, and curative therapy. Another interesting fact about children with the sickle cell disease and malaria is these children are less likely to develop malaria. But what is the exact mechanism? That remains unknown. But the plasmodium is responsible for production of malaria. That we know already. These organisms are unable to multiply sufficiently within the erythrocyte, and some studies suggest increased sickling in infected RBC. The plasmodium, in order to complete the life cycle, they need erythrocyte or RBC. But in children with the sickle cell disease, the RBCs are malformed or they have abnormal hemoglobin. So there is unfavorable environment for this organism to multiply. And also, some studies suggest that if there is entry of plasmodium into the RBC, there is sickling. That's why the malaria is less common in children with the sickle cell disease. Why I ensures this is, it is another important MCQ in the staffness examination. Coming to the summary of this disease, since this is such an important topic and detailed topic, we have covered the condition under two videos. Here is a summary. Sickle cell syndrome are hereditary hemoglobinopathies. Homozygous sickle cell anemia is the most common type, and that is autosomal recessive, and the genotype is HBSS. It occurs predominantly in individuals of African and Eastern Mediterranean descent. Sickle cell trait is heterozygous, that is HBSA, and they are carriers. A point mutation in the beta chain of hemoglobin leads to substitution of glutamic acid by valine, thus changing the structure and properties of hemoglobin. Abnormal hemoglobin polymerizes with the deoxygenated, resulting in sickle-shaped erythrocyte and cause vascular occlusion and ischemia. This is the basic mechanism of clinical manifestation and complication. Sickle cell anemia manifests in early childhood, that is after 6 months, with the symptoms associated with the vascular occlusion and hemolytic anemia. Each point written here is important for MCQ. The infarction in the spleen, kidney, bone, CNS and other organ are common and cause progressive loss of organ function. It can cause acute and chronic pain in different parts of the body. Acute and painful vaso-occlusive crises are provoked by condition associated with the reduced oxygen tension. Neonatal screening can be done to identify sickle cell anemia. In older children and adults, hemoglobin quantification tests are used to diagnose the condition. The cornerstones of treatment include management of painful vaso-occlusive crisis, hemolytic anemia, disease complication, as well as prevention of infection. The only curative treatment is allogeneic bone marrow transplantation. Here is the end of this video. Very important video for staff nurse selection and nursing students in their university examination. Please subscribe and share.